have walked me through the valley of the shadows dark and low, and that's reason enough to believe.
The scripture reading this morning is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Therefore, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come. Now all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Namely, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting the trespasses against them, and he has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were entreating through us. We beg you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. He made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him.
It's a privilege this morning to be here to share with you. And as I look out over the congregation this morning, I thank God for each one of you that are here today, those of you that have taken the time to come to worship the Lord and to praise him. What a privilege that is. And as I think of our country right now, I was listening to Fox News last night. Judge Jeanine had a two-hour segment on there. And one of the themes that kept coming around was that our country is on the verge of anarchy. When you have all of these incidents that have happened and you have the protests, you know, they shut down the I-95 freeway in Minneapolis yesterday for 6 hours. And the night before, the same thing happened in Atlanta. You just have a whole thing of anarchy developing in the country. And we really need to be in prayer for our country. When you look back at the history of the United States, we've had some great revivals. And when you look at those revivals and how they've come at great crisis in the land. And I really believe that we're in a time such as that right now. And so I would ask all of you that know how to pray and take time this week and just pray for our country. Pray for our leaders. We've been asked to do that in Scripture. So let's just take a moment now and maybe silently pray for the country. And then I'll just kind of close in a very short prayer. Lord, thank you for this great land that we live in, a land of freedom and liberty that was founded upon the values of Christian faith and the Word of God, and yet we've drifted so far from those original founding values. We need to be drawn back as a people, drawn back to you, to your Word, to the values that are taught in your word. And so we commit our land to you this week and this day. We pray and ask in your name. Amen. December 25th, 1935, a young bride of about a year awoke that morning and was waiting for birth pangs to begin. She was expecting a new baby. She'd been married for a little over a year, and she was expecting that first baby. Great anticipating time for any new-to-be mother. I want to tell you a little bit about what happened in all of that. That little boy was born on December 27th, 1935. He wasn't born on Christmas when he was supposed to be. That's kind of the way babies come. They don't always come when we want them, do they? Sometimes they come a little early, sometimes they come late, but you know, with God, they come on time. The birth father was a French-Canadian pioneer who had carved out a homestead in the wilds of northeastern Alberta, Canada. When he came there in 1904, all there was in that part of the country were Native Indians from the Cree band of Indians. And the only way those pioneers, that pioneer survived the first years, they were befriended by a family of Métis who were a mixture of French, Canadian, and North American Indian. And that family taught them how to build a log cabin that would survive the rigors of the winters in northeastern Alberta. And they taught them how to hunt and fish. And that's the only way they survived that first year there. This pioneer had six other siblings that were there. His father was along with them. They had immigrated to that part of Western Canada from New Bedford, Massachusetts, where the grandfather's wife had died and left him with seven children, mostly of fairly young age. And so he headed west with that large family because they were able to get a homestead of 160 acres of land for $10 back in those days, providing they built a cabin on it, developed the land. And so those pioneers carved land out of that wilderness, mostly by hard work. Well, that was the birth father of that little boy that was born on December 27th. The birth mother was the daughter of immigrants who had fled the Ukraine at the end of the Communist Revolution in 1917, when the Russians had come into the Ukraine and were taking over all the beautiful farmland of the Ukraine. And so the Ukrainians, many of them were displaced and ended up immigrating to Canada. Well, this young mother was the daughter of those parents who had come from the Ukraine in 1917 and had been pioneers in another part of northeastern Alberta where a Ukrainian community had developed. Now, how the two of these got together, a French-Canadian father and a Ukrainian mother, I'll never know, because Ukrainians and French-Canadians never have gotten along very well. But out of God's providence, he brought the two of these people together, and this young bride that was expecting a baby was the mother of this young boy that was born. Well, if you look at me and you can figure out my age, I was that young boy that was born on December 27, 1935. I was born into a world of chaos and great difficulty. If you look back in history of Canada and the United States, it was a very difficult time. The whole world was facing a war that was started by Nazi Germany that spread across all of Europe and affected all of the peoples of Europe over the years. Well, as I went back over my history and began to put all of this together, which I wanted to share this morning in the form of a message, and if you have your notes in the bulletin, your sermon notes, you'll see the outline of my message there, and you can follow along. I have scriptures, and they'll be on the board as we go. You know, as I thought about all of this past couple of weeks, as I was preparing for the message, I had so many emotions go through me as I thought about how God puts together a wonderful plan for our lives. Whether we're born into a very stable situation or whether we're born into a very chaotic situation, God has a wonderful plan for all of us who are brought into this world at whatever time we are brought into it. For me, it was 80 years ago. Seems like a long time, but it's gone by like a shot in the dark, I'll tell you. It's amazing how quickly life goes by. And as we think about it, a lot of times we don't understand that God has a plan in all of this. And we don't understand how all of that comes together. But into this plan, a Swedish home missionary called by the name of Ole Larsen felt led to tramp across the western prairies of Western Canada. And what he would do is he would go into communities and gather Scandinavian people together, start a Bible study in a home, and eventually that Bible study in many of those communities would become a church. Well, that's what happened in the little area, rural area, where I was born in 1935. He came around into that area in 1927 and started a Bible study with Scandinavians who were in the area. And out of that Bible study, the Molaig Baptist Church was formed. And that's the little church that affected my mother's life and my life over the years. That little church is still going today. My brother-in-law happens to be the pastor of that church. We're going to have the privilege of having them in our home on Thursday night as they come through our area to the Upper Peninsula, where he has a niece that'll be married next Saturday. So my brother-in-law, Owen and Annette, will be with us on Thursday. Well, he's the pastor of that church. That church has had a great influence on our family's life. It was through that little church that my mother really began to grow in her faith. She knew the Lord in a personal way, but she had never related to a church that helped her to grow. And that's the purpose of a church, isn't it? It's to help people to grow in their Christian faith. And that's why you're all here as part of this congregation. And we're blessed to be a part of it at this time in our lives. Well, that I'd share all that story to share how that God puts a plan together, and we don't always understand how that plan is put together, but he's the one that does it. And if you think about it, there are elements in the plan that God has for us. And I've outlined those in your bulletin, and they'll be on the screen. I entitled my message today, Living Life with a Capital L. Early in my life, I recognized that I was a sinner. We're all sinners. That's what the Bible says. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." That includes everybody. It doesn't leave anybody out. When I was 7 years old, we had a grocery store in town, and my parents were friends with the owners of that store. They had a family of girls, and when we used to go into town, my folks would go shopping in their store. I many times would go into the back part of the store and play with the girls and their toys. And one day, I remember, I was seven, I remember they had a cute little metal wheelbarrow, just a toy wheelbarrow. And I snuck that wheelbarrow into the car and took it home. Now, when we got home, my parents saw the little wheelbarrow, and they said, "Where did you get that?" And I had to admit that I had stolen it. So my folks marched me back into the car. They drove back to town, and I had to go up to that family, to the father, and tell him that I had stolen the little wheelbarrow. I've never forgotten that. But what imprinted on my mind was that I was a sinner. Now, you can be raised in a good home. You can have great parents. And my parents were good parents, and they taught me good values. But here I, at 7 years old, had stolen, done my first thievery, okay? Now, I don't know what it is for you, but we all do things in our life that reminds us that we are sinners. And God's word is very plain in the fact that we are sinners. And if we're sinners, then we need a Savior, right? We need to have that whole thing rectified, or we'll go on in our lives and it'll be a mess. And that certainly was true in my life. I found myself as an early teenager one day at a wedding for one of my cousins, and they had free liquor available for everybody that was there. And there were about four of us teenage boys that drank too much. And then my 16-year-old cousin decided that we should go for a ride in his Model A car. And I remember getting in that car, sitting in the back seat of that Model A. There were three of us, and then there were two in the front. My cousin, 16-year-old cousin, was driving. And we went down a gravel road in northeastern Alberta that Saturday afternoon and came to a bridge over a river. And I can remember seeing the right rail of that bridge coming right directly in the center of that Model A Ford. And I knew that if we had hit that bridge that day, I would have been dead. I would have been gone. And my mother had been faithful to me in sharing the Word of God and sharing the gospel and letting me know through God's Word that I was a sinner and I needed to be saved. But I certainly wasn't, and I was running with the wrong crowd. I was doing the wrong things. But that day kind of woke me up to the fact that I was mortal. Teenagers, you know, many times think that they're never going to die. They're never going to face the end of life, and they do crazy things. And we have the same thing that goes on in our generation. I raised four teenagers, so I know a little bit about teenagers. I've pastored for many years, so I know a little bit about what goes on in people's lives. Anyway, exactly in July of that year, 1949, I was 14 and a half years of age. My dad agreed to take us to a camp meeting that little Baptist church had every year near a lake. It was called Moose Lake Camp. And every year they had a teenage camp for 1 week. And that particular year, my father agreed to take us to the last Sunday night meeting of the camp. Now, the speaker at that camp was a female that had gone through our denomination's seminary, and she had a ministry to young people. She was an evangelist to young people, and she traveled all over the country, United States and Canada, and she had a marvelous ability to communicate the gospel. And I'll never forget that night. My dad made sure that we were late for the meeting. You see, my dad was an avowed Roman Catholic, and my mother was a Baptist. And those two faiths didn't get along very well back in those days. That was pre-Vatican II. And if you understand, if you come from a Roman Catholic background, if you're not as old as me, you don't understand. But in pre-Vatican Roman Catholicism, if a Roman Catholic went into a Protestant church, that was a mortal sin. And my dad would never, never darken the door of the little Baptist church that my mother took my two sisters to. And so that night, he agreed to take us to a camp meeting because it wasn't in the Baptist church in town. But he made sure we were late. And I remember coming in there, sawdust floor, just wooden, plain wooden benches. We sat in the back row, and we listened to the service. And God was speaking to my heart that night in a way that I had never felt before. And I knew that I had to make a decision that night about what I was going to do about Christ in my life. And as the invitation was given, my two younger sisters and I responded to the invitation, went forward, and the pastor of that little church talked to me about inviting Christ into my life and making him my Savior and my Lord. And I remember kneeling down and praying a simple prayer. Not a very complicated thing to come to Christ, you know. It's simple matter of an invitation. Just because you're in a church doesn't mean, you know, you're a Christian. And a lot of people misunderstand that. But my dad, at 7 years old, when his mother died back in New Bedford, Massachusetts, had gone into his mother's bedroom. And on her deathbed, she had all of her seven children promise that they would never leave the Roman Catholic Church. And so in his mind, he was going to be connected to that church for the rest of his life. And he would hear of nothing else. And he was very antagonistic towards my mother's faith in many ways, and did not like preachers, hated preachers. I'd seen him drive two or three preachers off our farm because he didn't like them. He thought preachers made a living by doing nothing. And that was wrong in his mind because he was used to making a living by the strength of his hands and his arms. And he didn't understand that a pastor had a vocation that worked a little differently than a farmer. Didn't understand that. But anyway, that night, we kids responded to the invitation, and we all invited Christ into our lives. On the way home that night, I could feel the tension in the car from my dad. He didn't say anything, but the way he was driving and so forth, I just knew that there was just a lot of antagonism from my dad in what his three children had just done as he had seen them go forward that night at the invitation. And so we all went to bed. It was kind of quiet in the house. You know, when there's tension in a family, you can sense it. And we could sense it that night. We all went to bed. The next morning, we got up early. And you know, when you're a farmer, the cows rule your life. So the next morning, we got up. We milked the cows, came back into the house for breakfast. And then after breakfast, my dad and I went out to the barnyard to do our daily chores. And part of those daily chores was taking the waste of the animals and dumping it on a manure pile. We had what we called a manure, like a flat manure boat that we'd put the manure on and take it out to a pile where we'd unload it. Well, we loaded that little manure boat up, went out to the pile to unload it, and my dad planted the fork down, I never forget that, on that manure boat, and he stopped, and he looked at me, and he challenged my faith as a 14-year-old boy. He challenged me to deny the decision that I'd made the night before. And I still to this day remember standing there and looking at this big man in front of me, standing with a fork in his hand. And God gave me the strength to say, Dad, I will honor you as my father, but I now have a heavenly father that I will honor first. And from that point on, my dad and I separated in our relationship by quite a distance. Went through high school, lost a lot of my peers in high school that fall when I went back because now I had accepted another faith from what I had been practicing. You see, my dad, when I was born in a Roman Catholic hospital, and my dad had me baptized in the Roman Catholic faith. I did not know that, and I did not know that till much later in life. But I was destined to be a priest in the Roman Catholic Church. That was my dad's intention for me. And my godmother, whom I got to know later, told me the whole story of how she had stood in as my godmother at the baptism. My mother didn't even know that I'd been baptized as a baby. You see, baptism doesn't save you. It doesn't do anything for you because you have no voice in that. Somebody else makes a decision. And unless you accept the Christ who came to die for you, and you accept that as an individual yourself, you're not saved because you're baptized. We get baptized because we're saved. And baptism is a symbol of our declaration of faith in the Lord. Well, anyway, I didn't understand all of that, but there was a lot of tension in our home because of the two different religious beliefs. But in all of that, I knew that I was lost in sin and that I needed to be saved, and I responded to that. What made this happen is that I realized that I was loved by God. I wasn't just lost, but I was loved by God. How many people in this world need to know that they're loved? You know, there are a lot of people in this world that are raised in families that are very unloving, and they never really understand that they're loved. And it's very difficult to understand the love of God. But I realized that I was loved, and John 3:16 came to mind, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. What a powerful verse that is. God loves me, loves the whole world, and if we accept his love, then we have eternal life. Eternal life begins at the point of our accepting God's love. And that is so important. Another verse is Ephesians 1:4-7. It says, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him, in love he predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will. God's love is spelled out so powerfully and so purposefully for all of us that we can't miss it. God loves us, and we need to understand that. Another verse is 1 Thessalonians 5:9-10. It says, for God has not destined us for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we will live together with him. Here again, another verse about God's love. And if you don't understand that God loves you, you're missing the whole point of God in your life and in this world. God destined us because of his love, that we might become followers of his. That became so powerful to me that I then wanted to be led by God. And that's the next element in this whole wonderful plan that God has for our lives. We need to understand that we're not only lost in sin, but that he loves us, and that then we can be led by God. That is a whole concept of putting ourselves under submission to our Heavenly Father, to our Creator, to the God that made us. I was talking to my brother-in-law and my sister yesterday, and they had just finished up a week of teen camp, that same camp that I accepted the Lord at. And my brother-in-law said they had an 18-year-old high school graduate who had come to the camp and declared herself to be an atheist, declared that she did not believe in God and that she wasn't going to believe in God. In fact, she threatened to go home, to leave before the camp even began. But the director of the camp felt God somehow working something out in this young girl's life, and he began to talk to her. She told the director of the camp, she said, "Unless you can prove to me that there's a God, I won't believe in him." And so to the middle of the week, my brother-in-law said this girl was kind of adamant in her atheism against God. But the director of the camp was talking to her about the existence of God, and he had a premonition that came into his mind about a hummingbird. And he had no idea why God had put that thought in his mind. But he looked at this 18-year-old high school graduate and he said, Does a hummingbird mean anything to you?" And she broke down in tears, started weeping, and she said, "How did you know?" She had focused her whole life in a love for hummingbirds. She had hummingbirds pictures in her room, and she had studied about hummingbirds. And how did this director of the camp know that hummingbirds were important in her life? She had not told anybody. And from that incident, that girl came to know God's love. And my brother-in-law told me yesterday, he said, "I've never seen such a powerful conversion of a young girl who came from atheism to believe in Christ." You know how that happens, folks? That all happens because of God's love. God loves us. And when we understand that love, he changes our lives. Now, that young girl is going to the University of Alberta this fall. She'll be a different person. She'll have a different life. Because all of a sudden, she came to know God's love, and now she's going to understand what it means to be led by God. Well, that happened to me. And at the end of high school, I decided that I was going to do something that my dad didn't want me to do. You see, we'd had a group at our camp that summer in 1955 called God's Invasion Army. This was a group in our denomination that had started after the war, when young people came home from the war. One of our pastors in Superior, Wisconsin, had been speaking to a young people's retreat over a whole weekend for churches from northern Wisconsin. And as he spoke at that youth retreat, he had been triggered in his heart to challenge young people to give a year of their lives in ministry in our churches. He had no idea how that was going to work. His home had been, before the war, his door had been knocked on by a couple of Mormon missionaries. And you know, young Mormon missionaries give 2 years of their lives to do ministry in the Mormon church. And how many of you have had them knock on your door? Anybody? Just about everybody. We've all had them knock on our doors. Well, that happened to him. Then the war came and there were no young people around. They were all in the military. After the war, he was speaking at this retreat. And he felt led at the end of that message on the last Sunday night of that retreat to give an invitation for young people that give at least a year of their lives to serve the Lord in ministry. He had no idea how that was going to work. 75 young people responded to the invitation, came to the front of the auditorium that night and said, "We're willing to give a year of their lives." That was in 1949. Out of that came this ministry of evangelism in our churches called God's Invasion Army. Later, the name was changed to Evangelism Corps. And that group went from 1949 until about 1995. My wife and I were in that group in 1956. We met in San Diego, California. Believe it or not, after I left home on December 27th, my birthday, 1955, as I got on a steam train in my little town in Alberta to go to Edmonton to catch another train to go to Minneapolis where we would caravan out to California, I left home, it was 30 below zero. My dad took me to the train station with horses and sled on the top of 10-foot snowbanks. They were so hard. And I got on that train. A week later, I was in San Diego swimming in the Pacific. It was 75 degrees. I didn't know there was a place on the North American continent that had that kind of weather in January. Now I understand why we went back to California and lived there for 30 years. We wanted to kind of forget that cold weather for a while. And we've done that. Now we're back to it. So now we're going to have to pay the price and deal with winter again when it comes here in Wisconsin. But we're okay with that. Anyway, when I got on the train that morning, my dad looked at me and he said, "You can forget I'm your father, and you can forget about ever coming home again." And he totally disowned me, because I had a scholarship to the University of Alberta in agriculture, and his dream for me was that I would take over our 640-acre ranch, and I was the only son, that I would follow him and take over the farm. And so when I went against his wishes, he totally disowned me. So here I was, a 19-year-old kid leaving home for the first time, basically, with a dad who said, "Forget I'm your father, forget about coming home again." But you know, I knew that I had a heavenly father, and he was in charge. Not my dad, but my heavenly father. And so I left with faith in my heart. We had a wonderful year. You know, I got to meet a wonderful young lady that year, and later on we became husband and wife, 1959. But through that year, there were about 10 of us that had parents that were unbelievers, and we covenanted together to pray for them. And whenever we were together at retreats during that year of ministry, we would pray for our parents. About the middle of the year, I felt called to the ministry, and I knew that I had to go to college and seminary, and that was, you know, 7 or 8 years of graduate education. And I had no idea how I was going to do that, but I knew that God was calling me to the and I had to follow his calling. You remember? We're led by God, and we need to follow his leading. And I knew that. December of the next year, of that year, came around, and we were back in San Diego. It was 2 weeks before it was time to go home, and I still hadn't heard anything from my parents about an invitation to come home. And that morning, as I was reading my mail, I opened a letter from my mother. And she said, "Dear Leo, your father invites you to come back home and be a part of the family." And I read the story of how God had put his plan together in my dad's life. See, that fall, that little Baptist church from time to time had special meetings, and they would bring an evangelist in. And that particular fall, they brought an old Scotch evangelist in from the coast, from Vancouver. And the pastor of the church came to my mother and said, "Would you be able to keep this evangelist for the week? Could he stay at your place?" And so my mother knew how my dad felt about preachers, and she didn't know how to ask him, but she asked him. She said, "You know, the kids are gone. We have an extra bed. Could we keep this old evangelist?" And so my dad agreed. Now, how he agreed, I'll never know, except that God was working his heart, because he didn't like preachers. But you know what that old evangelist did? He was a smart old guy. He decided that he would go out to the barn with my dad in the morning when my dad was doing the chores, and he would get to know him. And he had a great sense of humor, and he would kibitz with my dad and relate it to my dad. So on Thursday night of that week, my dad went to the meetings. Now, can you believe it? I mean, here was a guy that had vowed in his life that he would never darken the door of a Baptist church or a Protestant church. But he goes to the meeting on Thursday night. He went on Friday night. He went again on Sunday. And that night, Sunday night, after the meetings were all over, when my mom and dad came home, my dad asked my mother if he could pray to receive the Lord in his life. And God changed his life. When I got home that Christmas, I heard my agnostic uncle who came over to our place with his family for Christmas, I heard my dad telling his brother, my uncle, about Jesus and how Jesus could change his life. As far as I know, that uncle of mine never did come to know Christ in a personal way, and I really feel sad about that. But right now, this morning, and I ask you to pray for it, my cousin, the son of my agnostic uncle, had a stroke this week. He's a year older than I am. He's 81. And he lies in a hospital in St. Paul, Alberta, with the right side totally paralyzed. I've been in touch with his wife for 2 days now, and I assured his wife that we were praying for them. My brother-in-law on Monday will hopefully meet with him, and I would ask you to pray. His name is Ernie Delaire. Pray that God would open his heart and that he might receive Christ. You know, God's plan is so powerful, and God puts it together in ways that we could never understand. You know, I don't understand a lot about how God has put together our lives, but I know he has. So we're not only lost in sin, we're also loved by God and we're led by God, but you know, we're also lifted by God. We came to Washburn, Wisconsin at the end of March this year. Our first Sunday here, our first day here was March 21st. Snowed every day for 2 weeks after we came. We wondered, why did we ever leave Southern California to end up in a place that snows every day for 2 weeks in March? Well, now we know it's 115 degrees every day where we came from, and we thank God for God's air conditioning that we don't have to pay the bill for. You see, our bills in California at this time of year went from $50 or $60 a month to $300 because we had to have the air conditioning on all the time. Kind of the opposite of here in Wisconsin, where you got to have heat on in the winter, right? And you got to pay the bill. Well, it's the opposite in California, but we're so glad to be here. I'm going to ask Judy to bring my wife up right now, my wife Joanne. She's been a part of this for 57 years now. We're going to celebrate our 57th anniversary this coming Friday. This is the lady that I met in 1959. We're married in August 15th. We're going to celebrate 57 years. We've had 4 children, 13 grandchildren, 6 great-grandchildren. That's how God has put our lives together. It's been a wonderful trip. It's been a wonderful experience. It's not without its ups and downs. You know, somebody asked Mrs. Billy Graham one day if she believed in divorce, and she said, divorce, no, murder, yes. Well, if you understand marriage, you understand what I'm talking about. But you know, through it all, we have depended on the Lord. And 2 years ago, my wife started on her trip with Alzheimer's. And I'm her caregiver. Living in Southern California was not the best place for us to live. No family around us. We have 4 kids in 4 different states, none in California. And so the beginning of this year, we began to realize that we needed help. If something happened to me, our whole family would be in trouble. And so between my son and Joanne's sister in Mason, Wisconsin, they found us an apartment in Washburn. I didn't know where Washburn was. I had to Google on the internet to find out where it was. And I found out it was a city of about 2,000 people. And that was a lot different than living in an urban area where we had 500,000 people. And so it's been an adjustment for us. But you know, God has, through all of this, and is through all of this, lifting us. And I don't understand how God puts his plan together. I didn't plan on my wife having Alzheimer's after 57 years of marriage. But you know, when you stand at the altar and you say, for better or for worse, for richer or for poor, in sickness and in health, you make a commitment at that point, and you follow through. And as hard as it is, I know, and we both know, that God is the one who lifts us through it all. And I wanted Joanne to come up here to be recognized as my partner through life, and that God has lifted us and enabled us in so many different ways. And I could go into all kinds of illustrations of that throughout our 57 years of marriage. But in it all, God has worked his marvelous plan for our lives. And if you've never accepted the Lord this morning, I would challenge you to think about it. It's not a perfect life, but it's perfect in the sense that God makes it perfect. And when his love is a part of it, he puts life together for us in ways that we could never imagine. We've been blessed to be a part of this congregation. My first Wednesday here was the men's group that meets with Pastor on Wednesday morning. And as soon as I met with that men's group, I knew that this was the place that we were to be. And we've just recently filled out our membership forms to become members here. And we're so thankful because we feel God's love in this congregation through all of you that I've come to know. And that's all a part of God's plan. And I just wanted to share that with you this morning. Thank you, Judy.
Thank you, Judy.
Judy and Denny were the first people we went out to lunch with the first weekend we were here. And so they become good friends of ours. You know, as I was thinking of all of this, how God loves us in spite of the fact that we're lost, and he leads us, and he lifts us, a verse came to mind that Paul the Apostle shared with us in the New Testament. And that verse is, if you want to put that up, "And he has said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is perfected in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, I will rather boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may dwell in me." Paul had an issue in his life that was not taken away. But God's answer to him was, "My grace is sufficient for you." And as I think about how God has put his plan together in our lives, that's the verse that came to mind. "My grace is sufficient for you." You know, I know the prognosis of Alzheimer's is downhill. It doesn't change. It just gets worse. And we deal with that on a day-to-day basis. And we have a neighbor, Sue Johnson, who's here this morning, who's befriended us and watches out for my wife in our apartment over in Washburn. And it's just been so wonderful. You know, how does all that happen? I don't know. But God puts it together, and God gives grace to us, whatever need we have. I'm sure as I speak to you this morning, you all have different needs, maybe different than mine. You're not facing Alzheimer's, but maybe you're a teenager. You're trying to find out where God wants you, what he wants you to do. Trust God. Let him put his plan together in your life. And I was listening to my Sirius radio station last Saturday as we were coming back from Wally and Karen's house up in Herbster, and they live way out in the country up there. Beautiful spot, by the way. On the way home, you know, that day we saw five little wolf cubs on the road on the way back. It was really interesting. But as we were coming back, I heard a song on the radio that came from Signature Sound, Ernie Haas, and I want to play it at the end of the service here before we close the service this morning. The title of it is Reason Enough to Believe. Listen to it with your heart this morning as Cheryl Ann plays it through the sound system. You'll see the words on the screen. Just listen to it as we come to the close of our service this morning.
Have walked me through the valley of the shadows dark and low, and that's reason enough to believe. have shown me endless mercy. Oh, why I'll never know. And that's reason enough to believe. So I won't wait for signs and wonders to teach me how to trust. 'Cause you've already proven, Lord, the depths of your great love. You took the cross so willingly and spilled your precious blood. And that's reason enough to believe. Yes, that's reason enough for me. When I took your grace for granted, I was granted even more. And that's reason enough to believe. Oh, when with compassion you convince me I'm not hopeless anymore. And that's reason enough to believe. So I won't wait for signs and wonders to teach me how to trust. 'Cause you've already proven, Lord, the depths of your great love. You took the cross so willingly and spilled your precious blood. And that's reason enough to believe. Yes, that's reason enough for me. That's reason.
Wow. When you think about God's great love, isn't that reason enough to believe? I don't know where you are this morning. Got all kinds of ages here. Kids, teenagers, mature people like Joanne and I. If you haven't believed this morning, I just feel led right now to just give an invitation to you to just say, that's reason enough to believe. I want to do it today. You know, as a pastor, if I didn't give you that opportunity, I would not be doing justice to His great love. And so this morning, as we come to the close of our service, if you've never believed in a personal way, I would invite you to respond. You can come forward. I'll be here at the front. I've got several folks in the church that have agreed to just be here, to be available to speak to anybody that comes. Young or old, rich or poor, healthy, unhealthy, come this morning. If you feel God's tug in your heart, that's reason enough to believe. We all need to respond to the invitation. So as we close in prayer this morning, bow your heads, close your eyes. And if you feel God's tug to respond to my invitation this morning, if it's God's invitation to you, please, please come. And we'll just have a word with you, have a prayer with you, and there won't be anything else. Otherwise, you're free to leave after I finish praying. Lord, how we thank you this morning for your great love. You sent Jesus to die for us. That's reason enough to believe. You've allowed us to have life up to this point, life every day. And when we accept that life, we live life with a capital L. And oh God, I know that there are people today that need to accept that kind of life. It's called eternal life. It begins with God in us and through us. working out his marvelous, wonderful plan. And so today, as we end this service, may we end it with great thought about your great love for us. And so I pray that as people respond, they will respond in faith, the faith that you give us to respond. And so bless us as we leave this service, as we share fellowship with one another. May we share it in the Lord. I pray and ask it in your name. Amen.
That's reason.